I'm Peter Wainwright, host of Peninsula Affairs on Radio Sydney, and I'm here today on the Lochside waterfront in Sydney. We've all heard about climate change and sea level rise, and we're seeing a greater frequency of extreme weather events. So what does all that mean for Sydney? Well, that's why we're here. This video is to explain what we know and what you should be aware of. Sea level rising is not news. Sea level has been rising for more than 100 years, but it's now rising faster, and there's some uncertainty about exactly how fast. Satellite data give us an accurate measure of what's happened since 1993. A sea level rise of 99.8 millimeters, or 3.93 inches. That's about 10 millimeters a year. Of course, that could accelerate because of climate change. However, that's only part of the picture. Some parts of the world are sinking, while others are rising. You might have heard on the news that New York is slowly sinking because of the cumulative weight of all the buildings there. In our case, the Saanich Peninsula is slowly rising at about 1.2 millimeters a year because of glacial rebound. When Vancouver Island was covered by the Cordilleran ice sheet about 19,000 years ago, the massive weight of ice caused the landmass to sink. As the glaciers retreated and this weight of ice was removed, the land began to slowly rise. This process is called glacial rebound, and Vancouver Island hasn't finished rebounding yet. Unfortunately, where we live, the sea level is rising faster than the land is rebounding. What we need to be thinking about is the relative rate of sea level rise. Sea level rise, or SLR, is the change in sea level relative to the Earth's center since a specified base year. In BC, the province requires us to use the year 2000 as the base year. By definition, SLR was 0 meters in the year 2000. We are now at about plus 0.23 meters SLR. Relative sea level rise, or RSLR, is the local change in sea level relative to the local land surface. This is what we really care about. Crunching the numbers, we expect a half meter relative sea level rise by 2055, 1 meter RSLR by 2115, and 2 meters RSLR by 2225. This, of course, assumes that the rate of sea level rise doesn't change significantly. While there's uncertainty about how fast sea level is rising, since January 2018, the province requires local governments to consider new flood hazard guidelines. A series of provincial and professional documents provide guidance on flood mapping and land use in relation to flood risk. These state requirements for buildings, subdivisions, and zoning should allow for sea level rise to the year 2100, and land use adaptation strategies as set out in official community plans and regional growth strategies should allow for sea level rise up to the year 2200 and beyond. The province also tells local governments what rate of sea level rise they should use.
Hi, Peter. Sorry to interrupt you. I jumped in to tell the folks about the rationale the province used for sea level planning targets. Take the sea level curve projected out to 2300. Give a high and a low boundary to accommodate uncertainty. Take the average through the curve for the next 200 years. Keep in mind that structures such as buildings and bridges are designed to last many decades. Over the next 100 years, sea level is expected to rise about a meter. Thus, buildings and subdivision planning must plan with this target in mind. For land use planning purposes, a further 100 years is accommodated with another 1 meter rise. There you have it. Back to you, Peter.
Sydney started following these recommendations in 2018, which shouldn't be a surprise. If Sydney follows the province's recommendations and there are problems, then the province shares any liability. If Sydney comes up with its own approach and there are problems, then Sydney's on its own. The province says we should plan for sea level rise of 1 meter by 2100 and 2 meters by 2200, adjusted for regional uplift. For planning and development, a flood construction level, or FCL, is calculated, which is the minimum elevation of habitable space in structures. The FCL incorporates relative sea level rise for the specified year with a king tide and a 1 in 200 year storm event, plus a safety margin of 0.6 meters. By the way, king tide refers to the extremely high tides which happen when the sun and the moon are in the right position. This happens 3 or 4 times a year. CRD's 2021 Coastal Flood Inundation Mapping Project estimated flood construction levels for Sydney. While the highest high tide water level and the exposure and nearshore topography, which both influence wave effect, vary along Sydney's shoreline, for CRD's study, Sydney's shoreline was divided into segments, and FCL was estimated for each segment. The result is a statistical estimate of the average FCL for a specified year, for example, 4.74 meters in 2000, and that 95% of the estimated FCL values for 2000 are less than 6.62 meters. Of note, a plus 1 meter increase in relative sea level rise is associated with a plus 1.31 meter increase in FCL. They're not the same. Sydney has an interim flood construction level policy, which requires that development of any property below 5 meters geodetic elevation requires a report from a qualified professional engineer providing a site-specific FCL and reviewing the suitability of plans. Since 2018, developments in low-lying areas of Sydney have been required to address flood construction levels. For example, this townhouse development on the corner of Orchard and Fifth, approved in March 2018, was required to increase the average grade on the site by 1.55 meters, that's 5.1 feet, to meet an FCL of 4.25 meters. The recently approved Cedarwood development on Lochside will need to increase the average grade to meet an FCL of 4.38 meters. As can be seen, the building frontage along Lochside is noticeably higher than the street. This is a video of the waterfront along First Street during a recent king tide during strong winds, but not a major storm like a tropical storm. As you can see, there are some concerns about the adequacy of existing setbacks in some parts of Sydney in relation to sea level rise and an increasing severity of storms. So what does the half meter sea level rise by 2055, 1 meter by 2115, and 2 meters by 2225 look like for Sydney? CRD completed a coastal flood inundation mapping project in 2020 to estimate these changes. Here's a map of what Sydney looked like in the year 2000 with a king tide and a 1.3 meter storm surge. This is a map of 2055 showing what a half meter relative sea level rise would look like. Now, here it is in 2115 with 1 meter relative sea level rise. Finally, here's 2225 with 2 meters of relative sea level rise, king tide, and 1.3 meter storm surge. It's pretty obvious that a lot of buildings and properties in Sydney will be affected by future sea level rise and are affected now by these new FCL requirements. Let's take a deeper dive. The CRD did a sea level rise risk assessment in 2015, which included 2 areas of Sydney which would be most affected. Here's their map of South Sydney,
showing the prediction for a 1 meter relative sea level rise with a king tide and a 1.3 meter storm surge. Then they used information from the BC Assessment Authority and estimated the value of land, buildings, and infrastructure within the affected area. The affected area includes the Anacortes Ferry Terminal and the sewage pump station serving the entire town of Sydney. They estimated the combined value at about $93.6 million. Of course, these values are from 2014 and would be higher now. Then they did the same for the Seam Harbour area. This area includes Van Isle Marina, the sewage pump station serving most of northern Sydney, and a good chunk of Resthaven Drive. The estimated value for this area was about $76.8 million. CRD's risk assessment gives a combined economic value for these two areas of about $170.5 million. But this estimate doesn't include the area around Roberts Bay and Mermaid Creek, and of course it's in 2014 dollars. So the total estimate for Sydney now would be a lot more than that. It's not a crisis. This is happening slowly. It may be too late to avoid the effects of sea level rise, but we have time to adapt, and there may be options to mitigate effects. And the town's been working on this. Everybody agrees that one of the early steps should be to do an inventory of what's vulnerable to sea level rise and assess the risk. CRD's work gave us a good start on identifying potential impacts and assessing risk and vulnerabilities. However, there's a need to update the results by incorporating wind and wave data site-specific to Sydney. The town deployed two buoys over the winter of 2023 to collect the data needed. These data will then be used to update and refine our flood and inundation mapping. This will give us the information we need to make a plan. Council has identified completion of a sea level rise adaptation plan as a strategic priority and has started to engage the community to promote awareness of the risk and a need to adapt to what's coming. There are a lot of things we're going to need to think about. Here are some of them. Storm drains have problems when the outlet is below sea level. Will we need backflow preventers? And where will the water go? Sewage collection systems. The pump stations will need to keep working, and we don't want manhole covers letting in floodwaters. Roads and walkways. Will these still be passable, or will they be canals surrounded by islands of raised lands with buildings? Electrical equipment and transformers may need relocation or floodproofing. Boat launches and marine infrastructure. Will the Anacortes Ferry Terminal and the boat launch need to be adapted? And what about Beacon Wharf? This all likely has implications for our community vision. Here's a conceptual illustration of Glass Beach from the 2018 Downtown Waterfront Vision. Does this vision need to change to adapt to sea level rise? And what about Beacon Wharf? Beacon Wharf is approaching end of life. How will adaptation to sea level rise affect future plans? Then there's our waterfront parks. We have a lot of expensive public amenities below flood construction level. What's the future going to hold for them?
As you can see, there's plenty to think about, particularly for residents in the vulnerable areas. The town's in the process of refining the flood inundation risk mapping using the wind and wave data they collected this past winter. Stay tuned. Radio Sydney will be exploring where we go from there.